Welcome to those who just showed up. Please, we're trying to get about at least three people per table.
Except this table.
It's got to have table with sticky. We should be more specific with our requirements.
Yeah.
We didn't have enough acceptance criteria.
We had a past feedback cycle. So.
That's good. Yeah, yeah. But you were the customer, right?
All right, shall we begin?
Is it 2 minutes. Two minutes.
Okay. Guys!
It's a game. We can't promise you'll have fun, but you will learn something. One more minute.
Show.
Half price tickets. You don't want to miss it. Come on in. Surprise! Should we get going? Almost. My watch says 1:59. What time does this session end? 3:30? Okay, 1.5 hours. Okay. Go ahead.
All right, we'll start.
Yay! Surprise!
Welcome. So we'll begin. So my name's Sean Dunn. I'm an Agile coach with IHS, and this is my colleague, Chris Edwards.
Hello.
And we're going to play today the value uncertainty game, which was invented by my boss, Todd Little, who's a VP of product development. Today with us, we have some helpers. We have some assistants who will be able to answer questions throughout the game. So we've got Lashman, our Agile coach here at the Bangalore office with IHS, and we also have Vincy, thank you very much. And Annie is also here to help us
today.
Give
them a round of applause. Thank you for your help.
So as we always like to do, when your boss gives you something, you change it massively and you don't tell them about it. So we have made some changes of our own.
We are an empowered self-organizing team. Yeah.
We'll eventually tell them about our changes, but the purpose of this game is to explore how risk and uncertainty impacts our decisions in software development. This is intended to be fun. It's a nice, fun, collaborative, but there is a learning objective at the end. So there are a few rules and instructions, and for everybody to enjoy the game, we need to make sure that everybody hears the instructions and understands the game properly. There will be times where we need to go and do activities and you work together as your team, and then there will be times we need to stop and listen to some new instructions. So what we will do is Chris is demonstrating. He's raising his hand at the front. I see Chris raising his hand. I will stop what I am doing. I will look towards the front, and I will raise my hand as well and stop talking. Everybody else do this now, please.
Great. I love how well that works.
And we will keep our hands up until everybody in the room is silent, looking at the front and ready to hear the next instructions. Perfect. Thank you very much. So we will take 1 minute to introduce yourself to your new team.
Go!
No, it's the first time.
We hang out together way too much.
So, the goal of the game, what you will all be doing together today with your teams, is to build a software release. So, you will have 3 iterations in this release, and you need to, you will build your software by reprioritizing and prioritizing your backlog to optimize value delivery before that fixed release date. And you're competing against each other. This team's competing against this team, competing against this team. You will win the game if you are the team that delivers the most points. And there's 2 components to the points. One is,
yay! Surprise!
Okay, yes, great, okay. So you will be the team that wins if you deliver the most value by the number of story points you deliver, the value, plus commitment points. You get merit. The company thinks you're a good team if you meet your commitments. So you can get bonus points for meeting your commitments. You will see in front of you an envelope with the team name on it. Please open that now, and we will introduce you to the artifacts of the game. You will need these things to play the game. Number one, there will be four dice in the bag. If you don't have four dice, please let us know. It doesn't matter what color they are. It does not matter what size they are. You will also have 14 user stories printed on little cards like that.
Has everyone found their dice? Has anyone, let me rephrase that. Has anyone not found their dice? Excellent.
Okay. You will also find a scorecard, and it should have your team's number written on the top. And you should see on your table what we will call the value uncertainty matrix. It is on your table with sticky notes, with t-shirt sizes on the left and t-shirt sizes on the bottom. If you don't like where your matrix is, feel free to move stickies, and that is the wonderful power of stickies. There is also a scrum board. You will also see to the right-hand side of your matrix, we have a scrum board for iteration plan, in progress, and accepted. You can also move that if you wish.
All right, is anyone not have one of these things? Good, okay, I think we can move forward.
Contrary to what the slide says, there are three roles in the game. The first is the scorekeeper. So the scorekeeper takes the scorecard and makes sure that the scorecard is up to date. The sticky minder will move the stories. So they are the ones to make sure the scrum board is up to date. And we also have a dice roller, and they're the ones who rolls the dice. You can move and shift roles around your cross-functional team as often as you like, but someone needs to be wearing one of these role hats at any moment in time. All right, so we're going to show you what the stories look like. This is an example story. You'll see at the top there is a story number. It's got an ID, and each story has a test on it. What does the test mean? Well, we work on user stories until the user story can be accepted. But we're not exactly sure how long a user story is going to take. We might have an idea, we might have an estimate, but we don't know in reality how long it's going to take. The user story is done, you keep rolling dice, the user story will be complete when the test has been met for that user story. So in this case, for each day of the iteration, you roll three dice, and when two or more dice are the same, the story is complete. So we will roll three dice. On day one, we roll three dice. Are we able to accept the user story? No, we are not, because two or more dice are not the same. It does not meet the test. Okay, so we cannot accept the user story on day one. So we move on to day two. We roll again. And we meet the test. We've now completed the user story. We can accept it, and now we put it out into the market. Do we get any value from it? We don't know. So we don't know what kind of value we get from this user story until we get it out there and we learn from our customers. And so in this case, the value we receive is going to be the sum of all dice. So 3 plus 1 plus 7. The value, the sum on the last on that last roll. Questions so far? We're going to do a couple more examples, okay?
Okay. Go ahead.
Got it?
Okay, good. All right, we'll have lots of examples. It'll be good.
So, relative sizing. We're all familiar with relative sizing in Agile and comparing user stories to figure out how big they are. So we're going to do relative sizing with these. So, on the left, we've got this user story number one with the value of the sum of all dice. Right? On the right, we've got user story where the value is the product of all dice. You multiply them together. Now tell me, which probably has a higher value? 4, because product, not always, but more often will have a higher number than if you just add them together. Okay, so yes, 4 has the potential, higher potential value. Great. Now, what story has the higher potential cost? Yeah, I heard 4. Okay, people agree? Okay. So that's a little bit less clear, but you know, our gut instinct or our educated guess tells us that's probably harder to get three consecutive integers. Okay, great. One clarification, this is something we weren't aware of, is if you see cards that say no ones and no twos, that means that none of the three dice are ones and none of the three dice are twos.
There's other ones like no fives and no sixes, or no ones and no twos and no threes. It's the same idea.
It doesn't mean number one. It means that there are none.
Yeah, we've tested this a few times, and this has been a common confusion. So if you have any questions, we've got volunteers to help clarify.
Yeah. So you roll 3 dice. The user story is complete when none of those 3 dice are a 1, and none of those 3 dice are a 2.
So if it was 5, 5, 6, you'd be good. If it was 5, 5, 1, it would fail because one of the dice is a 1.
All right, we're going to do some release planning, okay? So, do me a favor and find user story number 1, which has the big black border around it. Okay, so this is actually the one we just looked at on one of the previous slides. So we'll move forward, take that, and put it smack dab in the middle of your value uncertainty matrix. Right in the middle. And we're doing relative sizing, right? So we just need a reference. We just need something to compare to. We don't know how big this is. We don't know how small it is.
Doesn't have to be exact.
Doesn't have to be exact. And now look, we just compared a few minutes ago. We compared user story number 1 to user story number 4, right? Find user story number 4. You'll see on the matrix on the bottom, it's cost. On the y-axis, it's value. Now, when we compared this a few minutes ago, which user story had the higher potential value? 4. So you would place it above user story number 1. Which one had the higher potential cost? It was also 4, right? So you would place that somewhere to the right? Higher value, higher cost. Okay? How far? That's up to you. That's your team's decision. You can figure that out because this is just estimating. So what we are going to do now is you with your team are going to relatively estimate all of the user stories. Okay? And here's the thing. You can try to calculate all the probabilities. Unless you're Ramanujan, you probably won't have time to do it. This is like estimating in software. You got limited time. Okay? So work together with your team and estimate all the other user stories right now, and you've got 10 minutes to do that. Okay? Like, right on, right? Your estimates are going to be perfect. That's okay.
That's how that works.
Okay.
Everyone else getting finished up? Done?
Done.
All right, Chris.
Done.
Okay. And 2.
1.
All right. Awesome. Thank you. All right, we're going to do a little quick mini retrospective here. So we just went through a relative sizing exercise, and I've got a question. How is this like estimating in software? What similarities do you see? Complexity? Uncertainty. So you weren't, it wasn't exactly clear, right? So you weren't sure which one might be bigger. Okay, that's one.
Anyone else? This was easier. How was it easier? Okay, much more complexity in real life. Oh, we might question you. We're going to hold you accountable to this. You better meet your commitments. The uncertainty's higher here or in software? In software, okay. Okay. Right, yeah, there's often dependencies between our stories and real life. Yep, no, very good.
Anything we can learn from this so far? Any takeaways? We're just all waiting to see what comes next.
Let's get to the dice.
Sorry, what did you say? What was it? Was good? Oh, your team, your
the people
team
you just
well.
Met work better than the team you have back at. Is this what I'm hearing?
Yes. Did working as a team, you think you got better results, like better estimates than if you had just done it alone? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Good.
Are
cool.
Any of her team members here right now? No. Okay.
That's okay, the video's on the internet. You'll be
this is live streamed to YouTube right now.
Okay, so now we're going to start the game, start actually playing the game. So the goal will be to prioritize your backlog and reprioritize your backlog to maximize your team's score by the end of the release. And we will do a quick example of this. So first thing we need to do is iteration planning. We've got three iterations. We need to, at the start of each, we need to plan what work we're going to do in that iteration. So again, just a review of the rules. The release is three iterations. There are 10 days per iteration, and you get one roll of the dice per day. You can only work on one story at a time, okay? And you earn 5 extra commitment points for every committed story you deliver. Okay, but you forfeit all your commitment points for that iteration if any of the committed stories aren't met.
And I know this is confusing. We will have lots of examples.
Lots of examples. Okay, you must commit to at least 3 stories per iteration. You can commit to more, but you must commit to at least 3 because that's been your team's velocity for the past, little while, so of course you have to keep your velocity up, right? So you have to complete at least 3 stories per iteration. Next, you may commit more. You may choose to commit 4 more stories. You may choose to commit 5 more stories or 10 more stories. Up to you. However, you lose all your commitment points if any of those are missed. So you have the opportunity to earn more commitment points, but it's also, if you miss any of those, you get nothing. And then finally, we calculate the score as delivered value plus your commitment points. And we will do an example very briefly here. So we're going to plan the first iteration. So now that I've explained this, doesn't show up well. But what you will do is you will decide what stories you are going to plan into the first iteration. So go through your stories, choose at least 3, possibly more, and move them into your iteration plan column for the very first
iteration. Imagine there are 3 stories there.
So I think we need, 2 minutes for this?
Sure.
Two minutes. Okay, so 2 minutes. Please do this now. Go. Okay, do you want to go? Go. We need to go. Go. Go.
Go. Planning is over. All right. Thank you.
So you will see. This is just the top row of your score sheet. Thank you. So, top row of your score sheet. Now, however many stories you just committed to, whether it's 3 or more, you will write that number in that first column, number of stories committed to the iteration, okay? Now what we'll do is we'll start working on the story, and you cannot see this on the screen, but okay, we will move that story into the in progress column, okay? And then this is what the story you're starting to work on. You've decided to work on this story first. And so here's the test and the value. So we'll start rolling the dice and did not meet the test. So we write a X in day 1 to indicate we did not deliver any value that day. Now we keep on rolling. We roll again on day 2, did not deliver. So we write an X again. And day 3, Oh, we met the test, right? So yeah, two more dice are the same. So now we write in the value, which is 3 plus 1 plus 3, which is 7. Okay? We move that story into the accepted column, and now we begin work on the next story. Okay? There we go. All right, so here's the next story. We roll. Did not meet. We roll. Did not meet. And we finally, on the third day of that user story, we delivered 36, yeah, 36 points, okay?
Okay, and then once again, it will move into, you can't see it, the card moves into the accepted column after it's been completed.
So we'll move on to the next story. Oh, and look at this, we actually completed our three stories for the iteration, but there's 2 days left. So what would we do in real life? We sit on our hands. You're right. You're right. We do take this story from the backlog. So you can choose a story from the backlog and pull it into the iteration and work on that. Look, on the very last day, we got that user story done. If you don't get a user story done, you're still working on it. Well, what do you do in real life? It just goes back into iteration planning for the next time. Now we're going to add things up.
So, okay, what is the total accepted value? Can anyone, any guesses? Okay, we count up the total we get. 15, right. We only get commitment points for the stories we committed to, so 3 times 5 is 15. If you don't commit to them, then you don't get any extra points.
All right, so in the case, we'll show you another couple quick examples. So in the next iteration, they decided to be bold and risky and commit to 4 user stories. However, they only completed 3. So they delivered 16. So they delivered 16 story points or value, but they only met 3. They did not meet their commitment, so they get no commitment points. You committed to 4. You completed 3. You get the value for those 3. You get the value for those 3. So 10 plus 3 plus 3 is 16.
Yeah. Meeting your commitment is a binary thing. You either meet your commitment or you don't. They're a bad team.
Question over here.
Yes, you did. That's true. You still get those points.
You still get the value points. You still get those value points. But you don't get the bonus points.
Your scrum master is looking at you disapprovingly, and you don't get the commitment points.
He's saying your iteration failed. So in the last case, they committed to 4 stories again. They met those 4 stories, and so now they get 20 points. 4 times 5 is 20. So any questions, because we're about to begin? Exactly. Yeah, so if you committed 3,
So that's fine. So
yeah.
For this, if we didn't get this 6 points, you're saying in this case we committed to 3, we didn't finish this 4th one that we started working on, you still met your commitment. One more question?
When we are working on a story, for example, if you are spending 3 or 4 days on a particular story, still if you don't get a value, you can always change the story and you can pick a new story.
Yeah, that's coming up. There's some special things we can do. Before we get to that, at the very end, you can see your total score. This is a score we'll use to determine who wins. You add up the accepted value and you add up your commitment points. So 98 plus 35 is this team's total score is 133. So special actions, like Lashman said, it is okay to abandon a story. You can come back to it. You can come back to it later. You can come back to it later that iteration or in a future iteration or not at all. So you can abandon a story in progress. And you cannot redo a story once it has been completed. Okay? So, begin now. Start the release. And we have how many minutes? 15 minutes?
I think we can do 20
minutes. 20 minutes.
You missed your commitment, guys. Each team, what strategy do they use? So we'll start. What are you guys? You're team eight? So team eight scored 249 total points, coming in second place. Anyone want to talk about what strategy did you use to choose which stories you worked on?
Actually, we started with one simple and one tough one, and we failed miserably because we could not meet our commitment. And so in the second iteration, we actually switched to taking the smaller ones. We completed our commitments, and we got the commitment points because of that. Then we were left with actually almost, we overachieved that iteration, the second one. So we started with one of the most complex stories that we had, because we had almost 1.5 iteration left, and we achieved the most complex one. And because of that reason, our value is so high.
Thank you. All right, you guys are team six. 141 points. Oh, 277. Oh, I'm reading the number on the left. I apologize. Okay, you guys are the model team. You scored the most points. Who would like to talk about how you delivered so much?
Actually, we have started with very low kind of things, and we mix it with productive complex things and few story with the low variety or low complex, which actually bring we are end up with even taking the risk, few risk, like how actually we can take a combination of complex value and risk. So actually we end up with taking all those three. We are actually end up with taking only three stories in each sprint and the combination of all three. So we are trying our luck also, and then we crack it.
So you took some gambles.
Same time we learned that taking complex stories also, one time we got lesser value. Second iteration we got very high value taking risk, but third iteration we got very less value.
So the more risk you took, the more variability you had and how much you, yeah, okay. And team four, which is, that's 141. Oh, okay. Who would like to account for your guys' performance?
I'm not the scrum master, but I can take the blame. we tried the simple ones first. As we met the commitment, we picked up the complex ones. They didn't clicked, so we got the less value. We took a less risk. We have not picked up the higher value, whereas the principal says pick up the highest value.
Oh, you did. So you guys met all your commitments. Oh, that's important, because your scrum master's happy.
See, actually, we committed what we could at that time, and then after that, we would still be left with 2 or 3 days. At that point of time, we tried the complex ones in each of the iterations. And in each of the iterations, it did not work. So basically, the difference is that even if one of them had clicked, it would have been a big number. So none of them clicked. Okay.
So you guys started something hard, but then it wasn't working, so you switched to the easy stuff to make sure you got something done. Okay. But you guys just stuck with it. Let's just keep grinding into this. We'll figure it out. Okay, how about you guys? You guys are 168.
So I guess the first round we stuck to the rules and we took the most value, right? And we actually did very well for ourselves that we took one of the complex one over our commitment, right? And I think we were, you know, for the second round we were completely overconfident. We forgot the rules, right? And we just picked up something. We screwed up miserably, right? And third, we came back to the rules. And I think we were successful. So I think there was a mix of luck as well the first time. There was somebody from Vegas here on the floor. We imported somebody.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for sharing. So we went through how everyone picked their strategies. It seemed like there was a good variety of strategies, you know, some different risk takers, maybe let's really, you know, focus on getting our commitments. I've got the clicker. So I think someone answered this question, but did anyone abandon a story in the middle of an iteration when it wasn't going? Yeah. You guys did too? How about you guys? Yep. Okay. Anyone change their strategy? You started with one strategy and then told this isn't working and let's try something else? All right. So you're inspecting and adapting as you went. That's good. Okay. So what did you guys learn? What are some takeaways from this experience? Anyone? Say that again. Yep. You were allowed to abandon a story. The rules on that are ambiguous. Okay. Anyone else? What takeaways?
Right, you know, you have to take risk. You know, probably sometime luck will be right. But you know, we were playing it safe. I think playing it safe doesn't kind of, you know, help to be on the top. Definitely, you know, you may meet commitment, but you know, only to that extent it helps.
Right. Thank you. another question or comment behind you.
I think in this team we were more of commitment driven than value driven. So that's why, you know, we got 45 points for all the three iterations. But in reality, it's not as crazy as this, because, you know, there's a lot of probability and there's a lot of that. So I think the main thing is to inspect and adapt every sprint and learn from it.
The interesting thing is when we did the retro about estimating, people were saying estimating software was even more complex than...
Anyone else? Let's get one over here and then one over there.
Yeah, I think in the real world, we kind of missed that point that it's okay to swap. So I think once we started doing that, we did really see some value in it. Because if most of the time you pick something, you are committed to it, and you try to achieve the same thing. If it's not working, you don't kind of look if I can do something else.
So one thing I found common between the game and the reality is teams are more driven towards, you know, satisfying the management, and that commitment points is nothing but, you know, keep the management happy, right? Right? So it was a safe game, like looking at, okay, points is values are fine, but, you know, at least I should get those, you know, easy commitment points. So that is one thing which I saw common.
Yeah, we try to actually influence your decisions a little bit by walking around being like, oh, you didn't get your commitments done, you know? Okay, one more question back there or comment back there.
So we kind of assume that for each iteration, the luck will be the same, so you'll have a constant good velocity. But, you know, sometimes it just turns due to some external circumstances, in this case, dice. So we cannot really predict how it will go.
Investment that we get is very low. That's one of the stories.
Are you okay? Are you okay?
One 180 points. That was a high risk. Yeah.
Oh, but they're all ones.
Yeah. And we roll the dice and we get one.
Okay. So what is there? Is there an analogy to real life there?
Yes. I mean, that's very uncertain. Right? We were.
To the market and the client doesn't even use it.
Absolutely, yeah. There is definitely uncertainty in what we deliver to the market. We believe there's value there, but in reality, it might not be the case.
Yeah, and I think I agree to. I'm not sure about the name of the gentleman. At that point, that you know, in reality, you don't think of swapping whatever is not. If it's not working, take a break and start from the scratch, right? I don't think we do that. We stick to one thing that takes a lot of time. Mm. And high risk is high rewards all the time, so I think that it did work.
You said that I had a couple of days left, so you guys decided to do the complex stuff?
Yeah, because we wanted to take a chance and risk it. See, for example, two sixes in two dice, for example, uh-huh. The probability is pretty
less. In real life, would we, would we do that? I mean, if we have 2 days left in a sprint, would we go and take a very difficult user story and try to finish? Yeah, okay. Ah, 4 days, okay. Yeah, okay. Okay, yeah, okay. I heard too, and I'm like thinking.
Mm-hmm. So one of the things I'm hearing is that commitments were influencing your guys' decision making. In this case, when you'd met your commitment, your behavior changed. The way you made your decisions started changing. So the way I make my decisions, way I decide on what I work when I need to make a commitment is different than when I don't. So, okay, I think we've addressed this sufficiently. Okay, so in reality, there could be a large spread here. What we really want to do is focus, you know, in an ideal world, let's grab the high value, low cost things, work on those first, and do our prioritization this way. A lot of the times, though, that's not really the case. If something was high value and easy to do, somebody else probably would have done it already. So I think the comment was, there's the high value things also has high risk associated with it. So, statistics time. This game is mathematically solvable if you have enough time and energy, which we did. We put a computer against this and we've run this game through thousands of iterations. So, this is the real data. So if we created this same value uncertainty matrix using rolls of the dice, this is solved. So there were many low value, low cost items, and there were three, I think you probably all saw this, three high value, high risk items on the board. Okay, so this graph shows expected value. Expected value is value divided by cost. So this means if I were to take this story and I would play it for 1,000 days, what is the average number of story points I would deliver per day? And once again, the higher the cost, the higher the expected value. So we ran a Monte Carlo simulation. And what we did was we created two separate strategies. We had two AIs that ran two separate strategies. The first one prioritized low cost first. We want to meet our commitments. We want to make sure that we get everything, prioritize getting stories done over delivering value. And the second strategy was completely ignores your commitments and goes after the value first. Yeah, so strategy one goes after... It starts on the left and moves to the right. And strategy two goes after this guy first, then this guy, then this guy, then this guy. You have a microphone.
Strategy two would continue rolling on that guy for the entire release.
Yeah, so mathematically speaking, it makes no difference if I try it day one or day two or day three. The probability is the same, so I should still go after the thing that's going to have the highest expected value. Okay, so we actually ran this. Ran Monte Carlo simulation with these two strategies, and we did 100 runs each. And this is the result. Okay, so this is a histogram. This is number of stories completed. And on the y-axis here, this is the number of runs through out of 100 that delivered that. So easiest first delivers way more stories on average. That makes sense, right? If you're going after easy stuff, you're going to deliver more stories. Okay, the second one shows accepted points. If you go after the highest value stuff, you're going to deliver higher value in the long run. But there is a risk associated with this. There were 8 runs with this strategy that delivered 0 value over the course of 3 iterations. So there's a very real risk associated with this. But this strategy works in the long run. And here's just some averages. Easiest first delivers 100 on average. Highest first delivered 200 on average. So you're on average, you're delivering twice as much value using this strategy. But your commitment points, you're only gaining 16 more. So those commitment points are like a little bit of a bait, but they don't really give you anything. And does the market care about your commitment points? This is just an artificial thing we've generated for the game.
So I think I heard someone mention this example. So what are examples of things we do in the workplace that encourages decisions to be made certain way? And one example I can think of is, we need to make sure that we get things done within the iteration, right? So let's say when we're doing iteration planning, how often does this happen? They think someone mentioned it where, it looks like we've got maybe like a little bit of capacity in the rest of the iteration, but having stories that aren't finished by the end, that's bad, right? So what do we do instead? We try and fill it with sand, right? We go down to the bottom of the backlog, we find these little low priority user stories that we're pretty confident about, and so that we can fit them in. But why would you do that? Why would you not just work on the next highest priority user story, regardless of whether it rolls over to the next iteration? Just like commitment points, things we made up, iterations are things we made up. And so how do we let them influence our decisions when you could have potentially a 1 or 2 day head start on the next highest priority thing?
So commitment points are this artificial thing we've created, but what are some things that we do that are influencing the same behaviors? What's kind of the real life equivalent of these commitment points? How do we incentivize people's behavior in this way? Iteration, like an iteration burn down chart? Yep, exactly, yeah. So one of the subtle things we do, and I did this walking around, is I just ask questions. When are you going to be done? Are you going to meet your commitment? The questions that we ask people, the charts we produce, the metrics we gather, communicate what we value as an organization and what we want people to be thinking about when they make decisions. Okay, so in an ideal world, we'd have all these high-value, low-risk things, but that's really not the case. So what are some things we can do if we want to go after these high-value things to lower their risk so that it makes it a little bit easier, more palatable to work on? Any ideas? Okay, you could get some spikes. You could gather, you could buy some information. Okay, we could split stories. There's ways of just reducing the size of things. Let's take a big thing and make it a small thing and then get it out. Let's get some feedback from our customers early. Let's not wait until we're totally done before we find out that this is really a one and I shouldn't be working on it in the first place. So we're trying to show in this game is, and I think you guys have come to this conclusion through the retro. I heard, there's uncertainty in our work. There's variability. Things take longer. Sometimes we don't get anything done in an iteration. Sometimes we get a lot done. And there's this idea that commitments and other things that we do, questions we ask, metrics we gather, influence people's decisions potentially in a non-optimal way, in a way that will actually drive our decisions away from going after high-value things.
And I forget who the quote was from, but someone said, without risk, there cannot be value. We are developing new things that have never been done before. Every time we go down to code something, we are creating something that hasn't been built before, and there's a lot, and otherwise you wouldn't be doing it. Someone else would have already done it, and why would we be doing it again? So there is just an inherent part of risk in our software development, but that's where we get our value from. So it's how do we go back to our organizations and remember as part of our day-to-day work that, these things aren't certain. We can do things to help improve predictability, but ultimately there's going to be this element of risk, but that's actually where we derive the value from.
So thanks for joining us, everyone. So the top name on here is Todd Little. That's one of our VPs at IHS. He's actually the one that invented this game that we've now heavily modded. So,
which we should tell him about.
We'll tell him about it when we get back to Canada. So you can find us on Twitter or by email. This is actually Todd's book, Stand Back and Deliver.
Yeah, he's my boss, so if you buy his book, then I get a better performance evaluation.
Yeah. Is that the metric you're being evaluated on, is number of book resales? Is that why you're at a conference?
I should propose that idea to him. Yeah.
And then, okay, this simulator, we've actually put it on GitHub, so if you guys want to download it and look at the source code, run your own simulations. If you want to code review it and find the bugs that are in there that completely invalidate the premise, that would also be good. We have 15 minutes.
And there is another scorecard in your folders. So if you have something else to do, please feel free to leave. If you had so much fun and you want to try a new strategy with your team because you had a retrospective and you want to continuously improve and learn, feel free to take the scorecard out and use the last 15 minutes to run another release, and we will happily take the scores because we're going to collect the data. So
thank you, everyone. It was a pleasure.
Lashman's reminding me to we should practice our ending.
Oh, wait. Thank you to our volunteers first. Yeah, I can't believe I forgot about that.
Yeah. So thank you, Lashman. Thank you, Annie. And thank you. Sorry.
Sukriya? Sukriya?
Shukriya.
Shukriya. I'm learning. And it's not late enough. Shubharatri. But that's the other word I know. Sorry, it's not even yet. Shubharatri? Shubharatri.
Three.
I'll get this down.
Shubharatri.
We're here for 2 more weeks. We'll figure this out. I'm sorry. How do I say I'm sorry?